In this video, we're going to do the z-score and the standard normal. So let's say you have a factory, you're creating cereals, right? And you put them in these boxes. And you want to know if the boxes, you know, you're on average, you're putting 12 ounces, right? Because if it's less, the government will get on you. If it's more, you're giving more to the customer and you're going to be losing money. So, you know, you're creating these boxes. Every hour you choose a certain amount of boxes, right? And we'll just say that let X be the weight of the content of the cereal box. Every hour you get a random sample. You measure, you weigh the amount of the cereal. And that's, you know, you write it down. Eventually, you'll have a lot of data over the many weeks. And so every orange dot here is a measurement in weight. Eventually, it starts to become a very smooth type of graph. We call this particular graph the normal distribution. And it's bell-shaped and so forth. It also has some parameters. It has a mean, a population mean of 12, and a population standard deviation of 0.1. Why is it population mean and population standard deviation instead of just the sample mean or the sample standard deviation? It's because you've done it so many times. And we're talking about a lot. We're not talking about 25 times. We're talking about thousands of times. Eventually, you have some type of pattern. Okay. The question is, what is the probability of choosing at random a box at the store with more than 12.2 ounces, right? So what's the probability of a cereal box that has a weight greater than 12.2? If you look at this, here's 12.2. This is the area we're talking about right here. I'm going to shade it in a little while. But it doesn't look like in the factory, when you randomly chose the boxes, there weren't many boxes that had a weight larger than 12.2. As a matter of fact, very quickly, if you wanted to find the probability of the weight of the box, that's between 11.9 to 12.1. Right, which is from here. Let me choose a different color. Actually, from here to here, right? Well, that's going to be approximately 68%. How do I know that? Well, that's the reason I know that is because the standard deviation is 0.1. So the mean is right here. The standard deviation, which is the spread, one standard deviation is right here, and then one standard deviation is over here, right? You can think of it as below average, above average, right? So one standard deviation to the left, one standard deviation to the right, that's 68%, okay? But we're not looking for that. That's just something very, something that you might remember or recognize as the empirical rule. Okay, so we're going to convert our random variable x into the standard normal because we need to use the z-score table, okay? And to use the z-score table, we got to use this formula right here. The z-score formula, okay? This formula connects these two distributions, okay? The cool thing about the standard normal is that it's one table, and that table corresponds to almost all of the all or any normal distribution that you can think of, okay? Normal distributions, that in this context is not skewed, okay? Okay, so what do we do next? Well, we plug in the values, all right? and we have the z-score that we need for our table. And you can see that x on our formula is the value that we're looking for. Mu is going to be 12, which is this 12, which they'll tell you in the problem. Standard deviation, right, is going to be 0.1. You subtract and divide, and you have this answer right here, which is a z-score of 2. So the probability that the z-score is greater than 2, right? Now, you might think, how does that happen? Well, if you think about it this way, probability of x is greater than 12.2, you can think of it as the probability of x minus mu over sigma is greater than 12.2 minus mu over sigma. Okay, we haven't done anything. We just, you know, subtracted and divided. And then, you know, you put more numbers in here, right? As a matter of fact, we'll just erase this one and this one. And then we'll just add 12 and 0.1. And you get this to be z greater than, this math is 2. Okay. And that's how we get this. That right here, this right here is something that some teachers will use. You don't see it as often, but that's how you would get that. This is more of a shortcut. All right. So the area that I'm looking for, right? Because when we talk about probability in a standard normal, we're talking about some area under the curve. And it says z is greater than 2. Here's 2, and that's this direction. So this blue area, that's the area I'm looking for. The incredible thing and the cool thing is that this and this, they are the same. Okay? They're related because they're connected to this formula. So this, which is the probability of x being greater than 12.2, that's the area that we're looking for, that blue area. Now, we know for a fact that this blue area, right, which is this blue area, is not going to be 50%, 80%. It's going to be small, right? Because these orange dots, right, are measurements of the content of the cereal boxes. And you can see that on average, you know, most likely you're going to get it maybe something that's close to 12 ounces, right? Because there's a lot of dots. Over here in this blue area, there's not many dots. So you're expecting the probability to be smaller. Another way of describing this is if you shaded everything from 0 all the way to the right, that would be what? That's right, 50%. And we know that this blue area, the shaded piece, is not 50%. Okay, let's move on. We look at our z-score table, and there's several types of z-score tables. You're going to have to make sure you know how to read the table. And in this case, we need to know this empty area right here. Okay, from 0 to 2, we have to look it up in the table, our table. The table that we're using, if you look in the bottom, it's going to look like this, okay? There are other tables, if you look in the bottom, that might look something like this, okay? So we're using the table that has this picture on the bottom. All right. Anyway, you have to know how to read the table. We have this value. And we know that from 0 all the way out to the right is 0.5000, which is 50%, half, right? So I'm going to subtract 0.4472. I'm going to subtract that from 0.5000. And we get this value right here, which is 2.28%, okay? Very small. This value here, right? Again, corresponds to this value, the answer for this. All right. So you have 0.0228 for the area under the curve for the standard normal. It's the same thing as the area under the curve for the normal distribution. Okay. And so the answer for our problem is going to be the probability that a box, that you choose a box at random, has a weight of the content larger than 12.2 would be approximately 0.0228. Okay. And if you want to write it out, there is a 0.0228 chance of choosing a box at random, I forgot random, that is more than 12.2 ounces. That makes a lot of sense, okay? You have a factory that's manufacturing these boxes, thousands of boxes an hour. You randomly choose boxes every hour. You weigh them. Overall, there's a pattern that you get, which is the normal distribution. You know that most boxes are in the mean. That's the whole idea about the mean. That's where the action is, especially if you're talking about the normal distribution. The cool thing is that you don't necessarily need the data from these boxes as long as you know the parameters, mu and sigma. You also know it's a normal distribution, right? It's not skewed, but normal. Then you can convert these numbers into the standard normal. And you'll have one table that you can use. And that table is used for other things. And then you can answer questions like this, okay? Hard part is to figure out, you know, how to read the table, how to draw it. Yes, there are ways to merge these two distributions into one. But for now, hopefully, that gives you a sense of how to do these problems.